Do you recognize this place? The city of Dublin, that's where it is. I was born and bred in Dublin, spent all my life here, in these very streets. This was me beat, though to tell you the truth, I wouldn't recognize much of it now. Of course, that was 60 years ago, and a lot can change in 60 years. 1925, well, that's more than 60 years. I remember now, Mountjoy Square, a Gardner Place, and on through Parnell Square into the little lane at the back of Dominic Street Church. Trinity Sunday, the 7th of June, 1925. I went out like a light, right on the side of the street. This is the spot, where the cross is now.
Can you credit it? That's me, Matt Talbot. Born in Dublin, bred in Dublin, lived all my life in Dublin. Died in Dublin. And after my death, there was this gentleman. He wrote a book about me, Sir Joseph Glynn. The Life of Matt Talbot, he called it. Can you beat that? There wasn't much of a life.
To start at the beginning, first things first, as they say in Dublin.
Now that's St. Laurence O'Toole's Christian Brothers School. St. Laurence O'Toole is the patron saint of Dublin. I attended there for a year, until I was 8. Then I had to stay at home and look after the brothers and sisters.
When I was 11, my mother sent me here, to O'Connell School's Christian Brothers, best school in Dublin.
School, boys, school and be contented. Cheer up the inspectors at the door. If you don't let me in, I will break the door in, and you'll never see your mammy anymore.
Of course, the buildings is all new now. I was out again when I was 12, barely able to read and write. I was a mitcher. Me and the brother would give Ma the slip and go off down the canal for the day. Oh, we were the smart boyos we were. At least we thought we were. I ended up a messenger boy. All I was fit for.
Messrs. E and J Burke, wine merchants and butlers to the trade.
Most of the time I was either bottling Guinness or delivering it round the pubs. In between times, I was drinking it. Did you ever try Guinness? Great stuff. Oh, great stuff. By the time I was 14, I was a drunkard. For the next 14 years, I stayed a drunkard. Have you any idea of what it's like to be a drunkard? They call them alcoholics now, but we call them drunkards. And that's what I was, a drunkard. I didn't just get drunk every now and then. I got drunk all the time. Every day after work, I made a beeline for the pub. I stayed there till closing time.
They had to throw me out, or I'd never gone home.
At least I never married. I'd only have made some poor woman's life a misery. Not that I had any time for the ladies, or cards, or swimming, or anything else that the lads were doing. Only the jar, I used to hand up my wages to the publicans when I got them over Saturday. I'd have drunk them to Tuesday. Then I'd have to pawn my coat or even my boots to keep me going for the rest of the week. When I'd nothing left to pawn, I'd steal. I'd steal anything from anybody. There was a beggar man played a fiddle outside one of the pubs to make a few bob. One day I stole the fiddle. I pawned it for the drink. It was his only living. I think that was the worst thing I ever did in my life. The craving for the drink, the craving was so strong. I'd have robbed my own mother, so help me. I'd be out of my mind with the craving, out of my mind. You've no idea what it's like. I don't know how many times I said I'd give up the drink. Hundreds, thousands of times. I never did. 14 years I was like that. 14 years wasted. I could have gone on like that forever, only for a funny thing happened one day. It was a Saturday morning, and I'd no money. I was on a terrible batter the whole week, never turned in for work at all. So when payday came around, there was no pay for Matt. I was skint. So I waited outside a pub where I'd meet my friends coming back from work with their wages. Friends, huh? Good day, says I to them. And they pass right by me. Not one of them asks if I have a mate, if I'd like a drink. Into the pub they go, leaving yours truly outside. And me with a thirst on me like the Sahara Desert. Well, good day, says I to them in my own mind. I know one thing is for certain. Yous are no friends of mine. You're home early, Matt, the ma says to me. I said nothing, only ate me dinner. I'm going to take the pledge. I remember she looked at me as if I was joking. Don't take it unless you mean to keep it, she said. I washed myself, put on my suit, and went out the door. God give you the strength to keep it, ma said.
And he did.
Went straight up to Father Keane at Tonliff College. I told him my story, and he gave me the pledge right away. I took it for 3 months for a start to see how I'd get on. I went to confession as well. Next day, the Sunday, I went to Holy Communion. I hadn't been to the sacraments for years. Mind you, all those 14 years I hardly ever missed Sunday Mass, and I said a Hail Mary every night before I fell asleep. I think that's what saved me in the long run, the power of prayer. I'll never forget that first Sunday morning, coming out of Gardner Street Church.
I stood on the steps here. I saw the rest of the day stretching out in front of me, long and dry like Dollybone Strand. I'd never done anything of a Sunday-only drink. The only places I went to were the pubs. The only people I talked to were my booze and pals. How was I ever going to stick it? I went back into the church, and I stayed for the next Mass. And the next. I stayed the whole morning till the last mass was over. And then I went home for my dinner.
That's what started me going to the church. The church was the only place I felt safe. It was peaceful there, as if I was protected. I had somebody I could talk to, somebody that understood. I could never have done it on my own. The craving, you see, the craving was so strong. But he got me through. He did it. The man above. The man on the cross. The first couple of weeks was the worst. One Sunday, I was at the early mass in Gardiner Street. When the time came to go to communion, I couldn't get up to go to the altar rail.
The body of Christ.
I couldn't move. Something in my head kept saying, go back, give up, stop fooling yourself. You'll never make it. You're a drunkard. You'll always be a drunkard. It forced me out of the church. I went to Marlborough Street for the 8 Mass. Only the same thing happened. To Beckley Road for the 9th. Same thing. I go back to Gardner Street.
Jesus! Mercy! Mary, help! Jesus, mercy! Mary, help!
I felt like a weight was lifted off me.
Christ.
I went in and received. No bother. It was him that done it. I got a little room for myself in Rutland Street. It was handy for the job. I was working in a timber yard down by the quays, T&C Martins. I'd start off the day by getting early mass in Gardiner Street. I'd come back and have my breakfast. Then I'd head down the Portland Row and the 5 Lamps to the job. On the way, I'd always drop into Several Place Chapel for a little visit. The work wasn't hard, mostly loading and unloading, checking timber in and out of the yard. Sometimes there'd be a bit of free time between loads. I could go back into my little hut at the back of the yard and say a few prayers. I'd get off work at 6. I'd make another visit to Several Place on the way home, eat me dinner. Then I'd go to one of the churches for devotions, or a sodality meeting, or maybe a confraternity, depending on the night though, isn't it?
Thank you. Reverend Borsa, Manute mission to China. Matt Talbot have done no work for past 18 months. I have been sick and given over the priest and doctor. I don't think I will work anymore. There's £1 from me and 10 shillings from my sister. These were my books. My Bible, the Word of God, and the saints. My friend, Saint Augustine, Saint Ignatius, Saint Francis Xavier, Saint Alphonsus, and Saint Patrick. Of course, we mustn't forget the ladies. The old Saint Teresa, St. Catherine of Siena, and St. Teresa, the little flower. Ah, they were grand getters. The saints. They went through sometimes, they did. I used to say to myself, if they could do it, Matt, so can you, with the help of God. Of course, it wasn't very easy for me at first, me hardly able to read and all. I had to go very slow. Sometimes I had to read the bit over and over again till I could understand it. There's no harm in that. When you have to read a thing slowly, well, now you don't forget it. It sticks in your mind. As to nobility of blood, true nobility is to be derived only from the blood of the Son of God. Blessed be his holy name.
After I'd done my reading, I'd pray. That was the best time, talking to God and his Blessed Mother, listening to them, the joy, the peace of it.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to thy great mercy, and according to the multitude of thy tender mercy, blot out my iniquity. Wash me yet more from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my iniquity, and my sin is always before me. To thee only have I sinned, and done evil before thee, that thou mayest be justified in thy word, and mayest overcome when thou art judged. For behold, I was born in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Thou shalt sprinkle me with hyssop, and I shall be cleansed. Wash me, and I shall be made whiter than snow. To my hearing thou shalt give joy and gladness, and the bones that are humbled shall rejoice. Deliver me from blood, O God of my salvation, and my tongue shall extol thy justice. For if thou hadst desired sacrifice, truly I would have given it. but with burnt offerings thou wilt not be delighted. A sacrifice to God is a clean heart. A humble and contrite heart, O Lord, thou wilt not despise. In thy mercy, O Lord, deal favorably with Zion, that thy temples shall be rebuilt, and the walls of Jerusalem built up again. Then shall they give offerings to thy altars. Then shall they lay fine calves upon thine altars.
If only people knew. I tried to tell them, but they didn't understand. They thought I was missing the good things in life. But God gave me the best part, and he never took it away. He told me things I was to do. Told me I wasn't to get married. Told me I was to cut down on my food and to sleep on a hard bed. Told me I was to wear a chain round my arm and round my waist. He put these thoughts into my mind when I was praying, and I knew they came from him. I never told anyone about these things, only the priest in confession. They were special things, small things, God wanted me to do. They weren't for anybody else. I didn't wear the chains all the time, only for special days. If I'd known I was going to die that Sunday, Trinity Sunday, I wouldn't have put the chains on. When they took me to the hospital, they found the chains, and they started asking questions about me. They ended up writing books. God must have wanted it that way. Maybe he wanted people to know about me. It's like he's using me. Using me to say something to people today. Now.
Maybe you're like me.
You're taking drink. You're taking drugs. Your life is a mess. You can't help yourself. You've got no one to turn to.
But you have. You've got him. He is my higher power. He did it for me. He can do it for you. Believe me.